Hello friends, welcome to GYS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on the channel, we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose, we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So currently, we have 10 series that focus on your prelims and one series that target your mains, and also one test series that covers your history optional. So those students who have their optional as history, they are most welcome to join our test series. So let's coming back to the starting of the video that as I have told you that we have 10 series, 10 topics. We have 10 series that are prelims oriented. So friends, what does we mean by it? It means that we have divided your syllabus into 10 subtopics like ancient India, medieval India, modern India, geography, polity, economy, current affairs, government schemes, and also other topics. And in this way, we have divided your syllabus into 10 subtopics, and daily we pick up 2 subtopics and we discuss 10 to 15 MCQs of each topic, and in this manner daily 20 to 30 MCQs are covered. So friends, in similar manner I can tell you that in 5 days your 10 topics are covered, and this process goes in a cyclic manner. So once 10 topics are covered, then again we start the process. So in this way we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is the prelims of UPSC CSE 2019, and we will end these series only one day before your prelims exam. So friends, let's start today's discussion. So today's lecture number 23 of ancient India. So the first question is, with reference to ancient India, which of the roles was played by Shrenis? First, Shrenis of merchants organized the trade. Shrenis served as banks and accepted deposits. Third, some Shrenis supported religious institutions. So we have to choose that which of the above statements are correct. Let me tell you friends that all of these are were the roles that were played by Shrenis in the ancient India. So they were the organizations of merchants, and they procured raw material and distributed finished products, and also they served as banks for the rich people who deposited their money there, and also they supported religious institutions like monasteries. So all of these are correct. So the answer is D. So here is explanation. So these Shrenis of crafts and persons provided training, including they procured raw material as well as distributed the finished product. And then the Shrenis of merchants organized the trade, and they also served as banks where rich men and women deposited money. So this was invested and part of the interest was returned or used to support religious institutions such as monasteries. Second question is, consider the following about hydraulic structures in ancient India. First, the Mauryan regulated and taxed water structures used for irrigating crop fields. Second, Sringavarapura, first century BC, hosted sophisticated water harvesting systems for channeling flood waters of the Ganges. Third, Iltutmish is known for dismantling of major hydraulic structures of Delhi as a part of his war strategy. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you friends that the first statement is correct. Yes, Mauryans regulated the water structures, and they also built lakes, and also they taxed the water structures used for the irrigation of crop fields. And also let me tell you friends that second statement is also correct. This Sringavarapura is a first century BC in this Sringa. It is near Allahabad. So it hosted sophisticated water harvesting system for channeling flood water of the Ganges. Regarding friends, third statement is wrong. Let me tell you that Iltutmish is known for building hose a khas for the purpose of channelizing water to this Delhi. So this he did not dismantle any major hydraulic structure. In fact, he built a house. So this is, let me tell you, the third statement is correct. So only 1 and 2 is correct. So A is the answer. The solution is 1 and 2 only. So Sringavarapura near Allahabad, UP, there exists an extraordinary example of hydraulic engineering dating back to the end of the 1st century BC. And let me tell you friends that the Arthashastra of Kautilya gives an extensive account of dams and bunds that were built for irrigation during the period of Mauryan Empire. Regarding friends, third statement, I have already told you that this is wrong, because the Iltutmish built hose khas, and it was constructed by Iltutmish for supplying water to Siri Fort area. So also in 11th century, Bhopal Lake, one of the largest artificial lakes of its times, was built. Let us move to the next question now. Third question is, consider the following statements about the views of ancient Indian philosophers. First, Maharishi Kannad gave the idea of atom as an indivisible part of matter. Second, Pakoda Katayama gave the idea that universe is an indivisible whole and atoms do not have any real existence. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that yes, first time the concept of this indivisible nature of matter after its multiple divisions, the concept is that the Maharishi Kannad gave it this concept. But in philosophical terms, at each matter that we see in this universe, when we keep in dividing it, then a stage is reached that from where the further further divisibility of the matter does not take place, and he named it Pramanu, and in English it is known as atom. So this idea was given by Maharishi Kannad, and let me tell you, friends, that Pakhoda Katayama, that is P. Katayama, in fact built upon this philosophy that atom is the indivisible part and the matter is composed of combination of atoms in different manners. And he didn't say that universe is an indivisible whole. In fact, P. Katayama's work was has built upon the work of Maharishi Kannad. So solution is one only, that is first only statement is correct. So here is the explanation. So idea of divisibility of matter was considered long back in India around 500 BC. So this statement 2 is also, let me tell you, statement 2 is wrong, because P. Katayama elaborated this doctrine that these particles normally exist in a combined form which gives us various forms of matters. Now let's move on to the fourth question. The fourth question is, the inscriptions of the Pallavas mention the number of local assemblies including the Ur. Consider the following about it. First, the assembly was found in areas where the land owners were generally Brahmins. Second, agriculture was not practiced in regions administered by Ur. Let me tell you, friends, that first statement is clearly wrong, because yes, Pallavas had various type of local assemblies, and in fact the places where the Brahmins were the landowners, the local assemblies were known as Sabha and not Ur. So Ur was basically assembly in those villages, it was a kind of village assembly in those villages which were not where the land owning class was not Brahmins. So the first is incorrect. Clearly incorrect. Let me tell you, friends, that second is also incorrect, because agriculture was practiced in these regions administered by the Ur, because ultimately village is the area where agriculture is practiced. So both the statements are incorrect. So the solution is D. So here is the explanation. Sabha, which was an assembly of Brahmin landowners in the Pallava inscriptions, and the places where the non-Brahmins were the landowners, the village assemblies of those people were called Ur. So this is about your fourth question. Let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is quite easy. The Indus Valley civilization sites among the following that belong to India are. So here we have to tell which of the following sites are in India. First, Harappa. Second, Lothal. Third, Dholavira. Fourth, Mohenjo-daro. Five, Kalibanga. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is, before telling you correct answer, let me tell you that Harappa is certainly not in India. It is in Pakistan. Lothal is in India, and yes, Dholavira is also in India, and Kalibanga is also in India. So second, third, and fifth. So Mohenjo-daro is in Pakistan. The answer is Kalibanga is actually in Rajasthan, and this Dholavira, this Lothal and Dholavira are in Gujarat, and the Rakhigadi is in Haryana. But Rakhigadi is not mentioned here. So solution is here you can see Lothal, Dholavira and Kalibanga. So the answer is C, that is 2, 3 and 5 only. So solution is C. As I have already explained to you, that Kalibanga was in Rajasthan, this Dholavira and Lothal are in Gujarat, and Rakhigadi in Haryana, and Ropard in Punjab, and Kalibanga and Balathal in Rajasthan. This Kalibanga has given the evidence of earliest plowed agriculture field. So please note it, this is importance. So earliest plowed agricultural field evidence came from Kalibanga, and it was revealed through an excavation by Dr. B. Lal. So it is also a site that has given an evidence of earliest recorded earthquake. So let's move on to the sixth question. Sixth question is Dhammachakka Pravartana Sutta deals with A. Order of the monasteries, chaityas and viharas. B. Chantings and prayers compiled by the major Buddhist scholars in Tibet and India. C. First teaching given by Gautam Buddha after he attained enlightenment. D. Interpretations of core Buddhist teachings given in Abhidhammapitaka. As let me tell you, friends, that Dhammachakra Pravartana is actually associated with the first sermon of Gautam Buddha, in which he enunciated the idea of four noble truths and all those things like middle path. And the answer is so C, that is first teaching given by Gautam Buddha. And this teaching was given by Gautam Buddha in Sarnath after achieving the after achieving enlightenment in Bodh Gaya. So he moved to Sarnath, where he delivered his first lecture to the five kind of we can say monks who were earlier whose company earlier Gautam Buddha kind of lived. So after that, he gave his first sermon to those five individuals, and that movement is called Dhammachakra Pravartana Sutta. So here is the explanation. So setting in motion of the wheel of the Dharma Sutra is actually the explanation. So he gave the first teaching to five ascetics in Sarnath, and with whom he had spent 6 years practicing austerities. So the main topic of this sutra is Four Noble Truths, and which are central to the teachings of Buddhism. That provide a unifying theme or conceptual framework for all of the Buddhist road. And this sutra also introduces the Buddhist concept of middle way, impermanence, and dependent origination. So let's move on to the seventh question. That is the next question. With reference to Jainism, consider the following about Tirthankaras. First, they delay their enlightenment to liberate earthly beings. Second, as per Jain legend, the birth of Tirthankaras does not occur in human form. Third, Mahavir was the first Tirthankara. Let me tell you, friends, that all of these statements are incorrect. First statement is clearly incorrect because this was not the case. Once individual attained the enlightenment, he was called Tirthankara. So the purpose of whom was to kind of show the path of enlightenment to the followers. So first is clearly wrong, and let me tell you, friends, that second is also wrong, because the person did not automatically became Tirthankara. He or she attained kind of enlightenment through kind of severe restraint and all these kind of teachings that the Jain religion teach. Let me tell you, friends, that the third statement is also wrong, that because Mahavira was not the first Tirthankara, in fact, he was the last. The first Tirthankara was Rishabh. So all of these statements are incorrect. So the solution is D, that is none of above. So solution is D. So here is the explanation. So as I have told you already, so there is no need to waste time on now this question. Let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, among the Pallava period bronzes of the 8th century, Shiva has been shown in the Ardha Paryanka Asana and Achamana Mudra. What do the asana and mudra suggest respectively? So during the Pallava period, so the Shiva was shown in this mudra. So what does this actually suggest? We have to choose the correct. He is about to destroy the universe. He is lifting Mount Kailash. Third, he is opening his third eye. Fourth, he is about to drink poison. So let me tell you, friends, that out of these, only one statement is correct. This mudra, that is Ardha Paryanka Asana or Achamana Mudra, it shows that Shiva was about to drink poison. So only four must be true. So here, there is no option that says only four is correct. So answer would be D. None of the above options is correct. But let me tell you, friends, that fourth statement is in it is correct, but the option doesn't show it in singularly. It is shown in combination with second. So D would be the answer. So this icon of Shiva is shown in the Pallava period and seated in Ardha Paryanka Asana, that is in which he's shown about to drink poison. So this is about your eighth question. So in other sculptures shown in ancient India, the union of Shiva and Parvati is very ingeniously represented in the Ardha Narishvara Murti in a single image. So So let's move on to the next question, ninth question. So this is the last question of today. With reference to the history of ancient India, who were the Piyadases? A. Traders who provided services to the midtown. B. Spies of military department. C. King was also called as Piyadases. D. Chronicles who wrote genealogies. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct answer is C, that King was also called Piyadasi. Basically, in the context of ancient India, we find this mention that is Piyadasi referring to a king. So this mention for the first this kind of reference to the king was first seen in the inscriptions of Ashoka, so which were deciphered by James Princep, who deciphered Brahmi and Kroshti script and was able to read the scripts of the inscriptions of inscriptions and rogue edicts issued by Ashok, the great king or emperor of India. So he referred to him both as Piyadasi, that is good, that one that is pleasant in looking, and Devampiya was beloved of the god. So this answer is C. So here is the explanation. So it means this Piyadasi means pleasant to behold. So Devampiya means beloved of the gods, was another term attributed to Ashoka particularly. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you like the questions, if you like the video, then please like it, share it with your friends, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and also do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications that we will do on our channel relating to UPSC CSE 2019. And lastly, friends, those students who want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, they can contact us at this email ID, that is achieveyes21@gmail.com, or they can contact us at this number, that is 8968426481. So this is our contact number, and this is our email ID, that is achieveyes21@gmail.com. So in case you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, then you can contact us at this number. And let me tell you, friends, that why these PDFs are important, because at the end of the day you will not be able to revise through kind of, you can say, standard books. So for that matter, you will not be able to revise by seeing the 20 to 25 minute long video. So for the revision purpose, when your exam is near, you must have some kind of notes or PDFs from which you can revise quickly. So you don't have the time, don't have much time to revise through standard books or NCERTs at that time, because that would be an utter wastage of time. So these PDFs are designed in a manner that they cover your concepts, that is both basic and important, in a comprehensive manner, and also the explanation is provided in a detailed manner, so that you can get a complete idea of about a particular topic, and then you are able to revise it again and again. So this initiative, basically these PDFs are designed in keeping this in mind. So if you are interested to subscribe to these, then you can contact us at this number or at this email ID. So friends, obviously there will be a certain cost for it, but it is kept minimum for the purpose of our sustainability as well as motivation, so that we can continuously help you people. So thank you, friends. Have a very nice day. Thank you very much.